Hello there, my fellow navigators, and welcome back to another episode of Dune Lore. The topic of today is quite a straightforward one, mainly the starships of Dune. Now, unfortunately, this is a topic that is not as lore-rich as you might think, but even so, there is at least one exception in the form of the Guild Heighliner. Now, if you've seen any artworks of Dune involving space travel or the Guild, you couldn't have missed the gigantic cylindrical vessels of the Guild. And maybe you wondered, what are these things all about? Well, today you're gonna find out. I'm your host, the Grimdark Navigator for today, and without further ado, let us proceed, shall we? The Heighliner is the main interstellar transport of the Spacing Guild. Although they did vary somewhat in size and detail, all Heighliners were fast, difficult to maneuver, enormous in size, and powered by the Haltzman effect. We're not gonna go into how space travel works in Dune today, but it is definitely a topic I'm gonna cover at some point. Because of their great size and the extreme complexity of the external neutrino circuitry which affected the translight displacement, Heighliners were very expensive and very difficult to build. Even at the height of its monopoly, the Guild, AirTags, only had about 5,000 of them. But on the bright side, these vessels were very durable, and like other elements of the Imperium, they never became obsolete. Accurate records for one particular Heighliner say that it lasted for more than 3,500 years. The earliest known Heighliners were constructed about 2 centuries after the establishment of the Guild monopoly, at the same time when Chrome was enjoying their most vigorous expansion. Within just another 2 centuries, at least 75% of all Guild tonnage was carried by the Heighliners. A later, incomplete document, a report from a Guild Yardmaster at Ix to his superior, says that even outside of the Heighliners, the Guild maintained about 275,000 smaller vessels for purposes of courier, passenger carrier, and miscellaneous travel. But the same report also says that the total payload of all these minor vessels together could not have amounted for more than 10% of the total payload of the Heighliner fleet. Under the Atreides, the Guild was constrained to devote a large amount of their transport capacity for military use, ferrying armies of Fremen from one trouble spot to another. But even during the Jihad years of the Emperor Paul Muad'dib, the primary use of the Heighliner was commercial. Although they were among the fastest interstellar vessels ever built, they were not adaptable to combat use. They did, of course, carry the vessels that did combat, but the Guild was careful to unload far away from any combat zone. Even the best constructed and best maintained machines eventually wear out though. Heighliners removed from service were not broken up though, maybe because of the risk involved in dismantling the neutrino circuitry, which by its very nature remained live for centuries after power had been cut out. The decommissioned Heighliners were thus parked in orbit around planetless stars. While explanations of the technology beyond Heighliners is available elsewhere, there are at least 2 features of the Guild equipment that should be remarked upon. First, the neutrino circuitry, mandated by field mechanics, relied much more on the sheer power than the elegant geometry specific of modern craft. For that reason, the Heighliner was a simple, featureless cylinder. The second noteworthy feature was a function of the Guild navigational techniques. Because the Guild navigators saw rather than calculate their routes, there was no need for the elaborate devices common to both earlier and later vessels. A Heighliner carried a simple radar and a small telescope, neither of which was really useful during tramlight operation. There is not a lot of information about the size of a Heighliner crew, or the conditions of travel for the passengers. But since all the Heighliners were fitted with gymnasia and other sorts of game rooms, libraries, and elaborate galleys, it appears that the Guild and its employees did travel in comfort. A Guild Heighliner was immense in size, upwards of 20 kilometers long, which is about 13 miles. All passengers were carried in the unpressurized hold, either in their own frigates or other vessels in self-contained modules. The hold of a Heighliner was only a network of girders and cables to which the cargo was attached, covered only by the light aluminum skin which carried the neutrino circuitry. The Guild did guarantee secure transit, but provision for life support, not to mention comfort or diversion, was left entirely to the customer. Taking into account the number of duty stations, the design of the various control systems, and similar evidence, we can estimate that the usual Heighliner crew numbered about 80. Up to 8 of them were navigators, and the fusion plants must have required the attention of at least 2 engineers. The remaining 60 or so were pilots, shuttle crew, support technicians, financial and banking staff, cargo workers, and so on. The energy requirement of a Heighliner was obviously very large. As much as 20% of its mass was fuel for its fusion plants. During a longer transit, refueling was also occasionally necessary. Waste heat was another problem for the Heighliners. As much as possible was passed through the outer planar fields as X-rays, a technique which actually made the departure of a Heighliner a more dangerous event to observe. Ordinarily, the Guild didn't orbit a Heighliner closer to a planet than 150,000 kilometers. A particular malfunction of the waste heat disposal system was the cause of the worst recorded disaster in the history of the Guild. It was in 11,286, on a transit from Harmony to Gamond, that the planar fields of the Heighliner salience overloaded. A transparency reversal resulted, sending intense X-rays inside rather than outside the vessel. There were no survivors. Records indicate that several systems malfunctioned at once, including all 4 of the failsafe systems which would have shut down the translite operation. Had not another failsafe system operated properly, the salience would have vanished without a trace forever. But the dead man switches of the fusion plants did work. When the supervising mentats died and released their grips on the laser triggers, fusion immediately stopped. The Guild seems to have concluded either human error or design flaw, though. And a few years after the disaster, the operating manual and the field transmission wavelengths were modified. Another 57 Heighliners are known to have disappeared while in transit, one of them even with an Emperor aboard. Nevertheless, the safety record of the Heighliners over thousands of years of service must surely be one of the best in all the history of public transportation. Another common type of vessel in the Dune setting is the frigate. Now, this is a generic term for the biggest spaceships which could land and lift off in one piece on a planetary surface. Although common usage makes it appear that the frigate means just one kind of spaceship, there were in fact almost 1,000 different designs that were all referred to by this term. The only common factor they had was their mass. While most houses, major and minor, did own a few troop carriers, and the richest of the houses had dedicated specialist vessels, it was the frigate which was the workhorse of all the house fleets. One of the more popular frigate designs was the so-called steamship, in which a fusion plant heated a reaction mass, usually water, but sometimes ammonia or some other light compound. Various heat exchange techniques utilizing plasma fluxes and electromagnetic fields made the system reasonably efficient, and it was also cheap to maintain. The same kind of energy fields around the launching pad absorbed much of the initial blast, so that the major environmental problem was the noise as the vessel rose above the port. A second common design was the so-called Brat, which exploded small fission bombs under an ablative plate at a base. This was faster, more efficient, and lifted more payload than the steamship, but it was also more expensive and left much short-term radioactivity in its wake. Maybe the most efficient of all was the so-called Torch, the exhaust of which was plasma. But the ruling houses were often reluctant to allow what amounted to giant heat cannons to come and go overhead. Because of the guild monopoly, no frigate was capable of translight operation. In interstellar transit, it was the frigates that were the cargo. In the confines of a planetary system, however, the frigate was dominant. No other class of vessel was so flexible, with so favorable a combination of size, speed, and surface accessibility. Obviously, no single frigate could be wholly representative, but we do have one story involving the Antioch, the personal spaceship of the Padishah Emperor Corin the 18th. This was one of the biggest frigates ever made, massing well over 900,000 tons and 411 meters in length. Its torch engine gave a maximum launch acceleration of 7 Gs. Emperor Corin the 18th, an aggressive scion of an aggressive family, intended Antioch for combat and even planetary bombardment. It had storage for 700 missiles and torpedoes, fitting for 100 las guns, and emplacements for a large number of projectile weaponry. Its shields were also probably the strongest ever installed on a frigate. But for reasons known only to the Bene Gesserit, Corin's favorite courtesan, which was a member of the Bene Gesserit, somehow persuaded him that the Antioch should serve court functions. And so, half the weapon was removed or never installed. One of the missile bays was turned into a ballroom, another into an audience chamber. At least one of the lasgun turrets was turned into a starshine conservatory. At the end of this story, the Antioch was never used in combat. Neither did it serve long as a space-going palace. It was first launched in 6890, and less than 2 years later, the Emperor was dead of poisoning. His heir, Harmon III, sold the Antioch to the Guild, and then it disappeared from history. On a brighter note, unlike Heighliners, Monitors, Crushers, or other specialist vessels, the frigate would endure even after the time of the God Emperor. And this, my friends, has been what I wanted to tell you about the Starships of Dune, especially the Guild Heighliner, for today. Not a lot, I am sorry to say, but at least now you have an idea about probably the most iconic ship of the setting. Do you know anything else about Heighliners that I didn't say? What are your thoughts on these gigantic space transports? Do share any thoughts or questions you may have on the topic in the comments below if you want. If you found the episode informative or entertaining, please consider supporting the series as it does not get a lot of views. You can do that by watching to the end, liking, sharing, commenting, and subscribing. Thanks a lot for watching, and may the blessings of Shai Hulud be upon you.